The word of the Lord says this: All who make idols are nothing, and the things they treasure are worthless. Those who would speak up for them are blind. They are ignorant to their own shame. Who shapes a god and casts an idol, which can profit him nothing? He and his kind will be put to shame. Craftsmen are nothing but men. Let them all come together and take their stand. They will be brought down to terror and infamy. The blacksmith takes a tool and works with it in the coals. He shapes an idol with hammers. He forges it with the might of his arm. He gets hungry and loses his strength. He drinks no water and grows faint. The carpenter measures with a line and makes an outline with a marker. He roughs it out with chisels and marks it with compasses. He shapes it in the form of man in all his glory, that it may dwell in a shrine. He cut down cedars, or perhaps took a cypress or oak. He let it grow among the trees of the forest, or planted a pine, and the rain made it grow. It is man's fuel for burning. Some of it he takes and warms himself. He kindles a fire and bakes bread. But he also fashions a god and worships it. He makes an idol and bows down to it. Half of the wood he burns in the fire. Over it he prepares his meal. He roasts his meal and eats his fill. He also warms himself and says, "Ah, I am warm, fire. I am warm. I see the fire." From the rest he makes a god, his idol. He bows bent down to it and worships. He prays to it and says, "Save me, you are my God." They know nothing. They understand nothing. Their eyes are plastered over so they cannot see, and their minds closed so they cannot understand. No one stops to think. No one has the knowledge or understanding to say, "Half of it I used for fuel. I even baked bread over its coals. I roasted meat and I ate. Shall I make a detestable thing from what is left? Shall I bow down to a block of wood?" He feeds on ashes. A deluded heart misleads him. He cannot save himself or say, "Is not this thing in my right hand a lie?" Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Father, thank you for your word, the book of Isaiah, and this passage specifically. May it hit us where we need hit this morning. Speak to us. And just be the God that you have promised to be in our hearts, the God of love, peace, and comfort, but also a God who cares about us. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. And hey, here we go. Last message about what the Bible says. Next week, we're going to start on the book of Ruth for 4 weeks. But this is the last week about what the Bible says about idols. Yeah, I knew. This is what got you up this morning, right? You didn't even need your coffee this morning. You're like, "I can't wait to hear what it says." Idolatry. It can take on so many different forms in our lives, can it? The classic definition of idolatry that's widely accepted in Christian circles is basically anything that takes the place of God in our lives, or anything that pushes him out from the number one spot in our lives. But to be honest with you, I think that definition needs to be tweaked a little bit. If you've got your bulletin and you read through it, there's a passage in the middle of your bulletin. I pulled it from a website, radicallychristian.com. This article I thought was really good. The author says, God isn't saying don't have anything in your life that's more important than me. He's saying don't have gods besides me. God doesn't want to be your top God. He wants to be your only God. To bring anything else into the presence of God, into the place where God dwells in our hearts, is to make that thing an idol, a false god. The best definition I've ever heard of idolatry is making a good thing an ultimate thing. Created things are all good things, but when we treat created things as ultimate, something that makes life worth living, then it's an idol. I found that to be a very good definition from where I'd like to get started this week. You see, in the book of Exodus, you've heard of this thing called the Ten Commandments, right? In the book of Exodus, there's this passage that many of you have heard before that says, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me." It's the first of the Ten Commandments. The second goes on to state what? You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. And it goes on from there. You see, these verses in the Ten Commandments actually build upon each other, and I think they're placed in a specific order to begin with. You see, verse 2 reminds us, it begins by reminding us of exactly who we are dealing with. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. God reminds the Israelites of who he is, of the power that he has already demonstrated to them. And let's be honest, I think if we're honest with ourselves, you need to reframe that from time to time, don't you? You need to remember who God is in our lives. So, for example, when you were a kid and you got in trouble, maybe you didn't have this, but I did, right? And I think many of you can probably relate. When you got in trouble, you were home, right? And your mom said, man, you did that. That was wrong. We're going to punish you for this. You went, okay, all right, probably. Now, if your mom came up to you and said, that was wrong, and you know it, wait till your father gets home. It holds a different kind of weight to it, doesn't it? Because you kind of spent the rest of the day going, oh, no, what is going to happen when my dad gets home? God was reminding the Israelites of who he was. Verse 3 then goes on to state that we are to have no other gods before our God. It doesn't state that we are to have a bunch of gods as long as God is our top priority. It says that you are to have no other gods before me. And there, verse 4 goes on to say, what? You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God, a jealous God. Don't make an idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. I hope you don't only interpret the Ten Commandments in these specific verses as only dealing with physical idols in our lives, because idols take on so many forms in our lives on a daily basis. You see, these are the beginning of the Ten Commandments that God was giving to Moses while he was up on Mount Sinai. And Moses spent a long period of time up on top of that mountain, meeting, communing, and experiencing God and hearing his word and instructions to this group of people. And what's the irony of the situation? Those are the first of the Ten Commandments, right? The first couple. And what were the Israelites busy doing while Moses was up on the mountain? Complaining about the fact that Moses was gone. We don't know what's happened to him. Let's make an idol so we have something to bow down and worship. Wow. You see, God begins these Ten Commandments with who he is and what his relational expectations are. This is not something that's unreasonable. It might sound like it. It might feel like it. It might be intimidating to you, but this is not unreasonable. Man, I'm tripping over my words today. I apologize right now. These are the normal type of relationship expectations that we have. If I'm going to be number one in your life, then you need to treat me like number one in your life, is what God's saying. You hear it every time you attend a wedding. Every time. Do you take this person to be your wedded spouse, to live together in marriage? Do you promise to love them, comfort them, honor them, and keep them for better or for worse, for richer or for poor, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others to be faithful only to them for as long as you both shall live? You see that line, forsaking all others to be faithful only to them. Without that line, the vows kind of fall apart, don't they? They don't hold the same weight. They don't mean as much. That's the entire point of the wedding vows. I mean, if you're going to condense a wedding into one idea, it is that of two people joining together as one. For this reason, a man will leave his father and his mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So if I were to read through you a set of wedding vows and it said something like this, do you take this person to be your wedded spouse, to live together in marriage? Do you promise to love them, comfort them, honor and keep them for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, for sickness and in health, but still giving you the option to look for somebody who's better or a little more suited to your needs around you as your life goes on? it really wouldn't hold the same weight, would it? It's not really a true vow at that point. It's not a commitment to the other person. And that's the same thing that God expects from us. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God, and I am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, is specifically what it says in the book of Exodus. Did you pick up what that said? If you listen closely, you can see and hear that God has actually equated the worship of idols with hatred of him in Exodus 20. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. So do you struggle with idols in your life? If you have trouble identifying what those idols would be, let me assist you. Because if you're not sure if you struggle with idols, the answer is yes, you do. That goes for everybody in this room right now. Just letting you know that. So let me ask you some questions to help identify some of the idols in your life. Number one, what would you be fearful of losing in your life? Both physical and or emotional. What are the traits that you view as making you unique and individual in your life? Those are probably some of the traits that can easily become idols in your life. What do you spend large quantities of your time focusing and reflecting upon in your life? That leads us to our idols. You see, this cannot be one of those subjects when you hear about idols and idols in people's lives that you sit there and you go, man, this is going to be a really good sermon for so-and-so. And I hope they're paying attention to what Pastor Scott and the Bible is saying because they really need to hear this. And if you're thinking that, you're on the wrong track because this message is for everyone in here. And it would be easy for me to stand up front today and preach at you and go, you guys really need to get this straight. You need to get this idol thing in your life figured out. Because look how important it is to God, even beginning the Ten Commandments with it. But this message is relative and pertinent to everyone here, and unfortunately, I'm not excluded from that group. So I'm going to share with you some of the things that I struggle with and some of the idols in my life. Some of you got to experience it firsthand about 5 or 6 weeks ago out at Little Pine on an incredibly hot, ridiculously humid Saturday afternoon when I was running a race. And I came across the finish line completely exhausted, completely battered, emotionally beaten, and my ego was stripped down to nothing basically at that point. You see, I had done the race the year before and had a good race, and I really wanted to better my time, and I ended up finishing about 2 hours slower. And it was just a terrible experience. I said to my wife afterwards, I said, if all trail running was like that race, I would never run a trail again in my life. It wasn't fun. I didn't enjoy it. But when you have a race like that, it causes you to do some introspection, to look at why did these things happen in the way that they did. And over the next couple weeks, it became obvious to me that running had become an idol in my life. See, running had become a source of pride and identity for me. It felt good when people said, great job in the race. I can't believe you did that. You did something that was absolutely amazing. And to be honest with you, it took that incident that happened to me at the Call of the Wilds, excuse me, to realize that I was no longer using running and my body as a form of worship to God as I used to. I was now using it for a form of self-gratification, something I received positive feedback and compliments for. You see, running in its truest form for me, especially when I'm on the trail, is time spent with God. Time in scripture, time in song. Yes, I sing out loud sometimes when I'm on the trail. Not on the road, on the trail. Most of my sermon preparation that's done in my head happens when I'm running, not sitting in my office. And it hadn't been that way for a couple of months. Some other examples of things that are idols in my life. The first one is good pastor stuff. I want to put out the vibe that I'm a good pastor, so I do good pastor stuff. I have meetings. I do leadership stuff. I do counseling sessions. That makes me feel important and like a real pastor. Stupid, but true. Television. Not the physical television on our wall, but the television time of every night when my kids, you know, we sit down around 8 o'clock, you know, just before bedtime, and we start unwinding. That time is a time where I just focus on the television, and I don't pay attention to my family that is sitting beside me. And if one of them starts to talk, I'm like, can you just be quiet for a second? Because I really want to hear what's on the TV. Instead of building relationship, I've gotten so accustomed to that downtime, that time of unwinding, that has become an idol in my life. Fitness is an idol for me. I am terrified, terrified of becoming unfit in my life. Hardworking is an idol for me. The ultimate insult that you could use for me is to call me lazy. I never want to be called lazy. I don't like it. It would be incredibly difficult. So I am hardworking, and that label, that is a badge of honor to me. And going along with that would be toughness, I guess you could say. It's the best way I could describe it. I don't want to fit the mold of the stereotypical nerdy-ish type of pastor that spends 10 to 12 hours a day sitting in his office, praying, studying, and being completely separated off. And we love our pastor, but we know, we all really know that if something important needs done, we're going to have to help him with him because he's kind of incompetent in that area. That's just not who I am. But I take pride in that too, unfortunately. And as I made my list this week, I found it very interesting that none of the idols that I identified in my life are physical idols, such as a golden calf type of thing. Yeah, we sit down in front of the television, but it's not the television itself. It's the fact that I've become so numb. So the question is, what have you allowed to become an idol in your life? I mean, can church and Christianity itself be an idol? Notice I didn't say God, but can church or your faith be an idol? I mean, I love it when I ask somebody, how is your church doing? And the response I'm looking for is, good, bad, anything in between. But why? It's like, look, are you being fed? Are you connecting? Are you unified? Is it a body that lifts one another up? Things of that nature. You know the answer I get 90% of the time? Statistics. It's doing great. We have 400 people. We have 750 people. It's grown 33% from 2 years ago. Church health on any level is not determined by statistics of population of people that worship there on a Sunday morning. That's not what the church is. So when I ask how the church is doing and I get a number, the first thing that screams to me is idol worship. How about this? Do you ever do devotions for a certain amount of time to measure up to another person or to impress someone? Is it your way of making you feel more holy? Well, I heard of this guy who does devotions for like 2 hours every morning, and I only do 10 minutes, so I'm going to try and up my game to like 15 minutes because I think that's what real Christians probably do. And you may look at me like I'm crazy, but I know you've all heard stuff like this and thought it before. How about this one? Why do you attend church on Sunday mornings? Is it an open and honest expression of your love for God and your desire to know him deeper and more intimately? Is it a guilt trip to keep the monkey off your back? You can check it off. I got church done this week. I'm good. Is it to impress someone? Now, hear me say this. No matter what your reason, I want you to keep attending. But reality is that at some point, your reason for attending must change from personal in nature in relationship with other people to personal in nature in relationship with God. How about communion? Why do you take communion? Do you take it because everybody else is taking it? You don't want to be looked down upon? I mean, I use this example because the question of communion is that communion should be such an intimate and solemn recognition of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ in your life. In fact, 1 Corinthians chapter 11 says these words. Paul writes, therefore, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. Do you really take stock before taking the bread and taking the cup? Because Paul takes it very seriously. I guess the point that I'm getting to is even our faith can become idols in our lives. That's what happened to the Pharisees, yo. That's what happened to the Pharisees. Did I say yo? Word up. All right, let's go with it. The Pharisees made the rules their idols. Jesus Christ addresses it in Mark chapter 7. Their holiness depended upon the obedience that they had to the tradition of rules that existed. Many of these rules were not given by God, but made by man. Jesus Christ says in verses 6 through 8 of Mark chapter 7, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to the traditions of men. They've let go of the commands of God and are holding on to their own traditions. He goes on later in verse 13 and says, thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. And you do many things like that. In our passage today, Isaiah wasn't quite as casual with his words either. What's he say about idolatry? All who make idols are nothing, and the things they treasure are worthless. Let them all come together and take their stand. They will be brought down to terror and infamy. They know nothing. They understand nothing. Their eyes are plastered over so they cannot see, and their minds are closed so they cannot understand. And he finishes off with this one. A deluded heart misleads him. He cannot save himself or say, is not this thing in my right hand a lie? Now, in this specific passage, Isaiah is comparing the literal worship of a man-made cast idol. Israel was a chosen people, and they were in a state of panic in this time in their history. Wars, rumors of wars, with big nations around them. Aram and Assyria had gotten to them. And the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah was kind of split against each other. And they're making treaties and allies with all these other nations. And what they end up doing is fighting amongst themselves. And Isaiah is literally arguing against the absurdity of a cast idol. For the most part of this passage, a wooden idol. Why? Because he had to. They were actually doing this. Isn't it crazy to try and wrap your mind around that? I mean, what's he saying? What kind of idiotic behavior is it? This is what Isaiah is saying. What kind of idiotic behavior is it when the God who previously provided for you, who protected you, who fought for you, takes a back seat to this wooden idol that you have carved and bowed down to. Instead of worshiping God, your creator and sustainer, you are worshiping something that you made and something that you used to keep warm and something that you used to cook your dinner over. It's absurd. It's absolutely absurd. And we sit here and we go, yeah, it is absurd. Newsflash. God feels the same way about your idols and mine. It's absurd. The words of Isaiah could be written for us today. See, let's be honest. We justify our idols in our own minds, but they are really and truly, utterly worthless. Ezekiel chapter 14 says, this is what the sovereign Lord says. When an Israelite sets up idols in his heart and puts a wicked stumbling block before his face and then goes to a prophet, I, the Lord, will answer him myself in keeping with his great idolatry. I will do this to recapture the hearts of the people of Israel who have all deserted me for their idols. Turn from your idols and renounce all your detestable practices. I will set my face against that man and make him an example and a byword. I will cut him off from my people. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I mean, it echoes of the Ten Commandments, the first three verses. New Testament says it a little differently. 1 Timothy chapter 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we'll be content with that. Are you content with what God has given you? You see, the answer isn't to stop all of our current practices or even to remove the idols from our lives. Let's be honest. I don't want you to remove church if it has become an idol from your life. You can't exactly remove yourself from your family if your family is an idol in your life. So the answer, therefore, isn't to remove the idols, but change our focus. The answer is to love God more. The answer is to love God more. For us to eliminate the idol worship that is presently in our lives, I would argue that it is not a once-and-done decision, but a process that we have to go through. One of the common injuries in the running world is something called plantar fasciitis. It's something that happens at the bottom of your feet, and it hurts different people to different degrees and different extent. It's an overuse injury. Some people can barely walk, let alone put pressure on it. And what it is, it's an injury that occurs over a period of time when you've gone too hard and trained too quickly without progressing and making the right steps. Your body gets overused and it starts to break down and you get this pain. And it's one of the worst runners in the world. It's one of the worst injuries in the world if you're a runner to sustain. You know what the prevention is, or you know what the treatment is for it? Stop running. If you love to run, that's not the treatment that you're looking for, right? Stop running. I have a friend who went through this. She had to stop running for 9 months. She ran 2 of the last 3 Boston marathons. She had to stop running for 9 months. Take time off. It's tough. Why do I bring this up? Why talk about plantar fasciitis? See, plantar fasciitis results from overusing your body. And for the most part, running is a good exercise, isn't it? Keeps us healthy, keeps us in shape, burns calories, gets our endorphins up, does all the good stuff. But plantar fasciitis, an overuse injury, results from doing too much to the extreme. Taking something that is good and healthy for the body and taking it too far when the body was not given a proper period of adaptation. But what's beautiful about it doesn't mean the person can never run again. It just means that when they do begin to run again, they need to be smart about it. They need to learn from it. You need to increase in proper increments. You need to keep it in perspective. Idols are the same way in our lives. They are developed over a period of time. They become a problem when they are given a place of prominence in our lives that is reserved for God, or when they begin to push God out of his place of prominence in our lives. You see, to many of us, idols are not a physical statue that we bow down and worship. Although, guys and gals, we do have physical idols in our lives. Guys, pickup trucks, sports cars, four-wheelers, guns, electronics, women, hair and beauty items, shoe collections. You're not immune to the electronic stuff either. Vera Bradley. I never heard of Vera Bradley before I moved up here. Vera Bradley bingo. Whatever. You see, we don't struggle with these physical items near as much, though, as we do the ideas and the concepts in our lives. Issues of control, issues of friendships, issues of popularity, issues of dominance in relationships. Maybe your idol is how you feel Friday night after work. Maybe it's Saturday evening with your friends. I don't know. So how do we get rid of idols? Scott, you're already run over. That's all right. We're not going to go much longer. Well, I went the wrong way. How do we get rid of idols in our lives? I have a couple slides I want you to take a look at. Tell me what you see. Because you're going to see one of two things here. You either see a vase in the black, or you see two faces in the white facing one another. How about this one? What do you see? A duck or a bunny rabbit? This next one's got some writing on it, so I don't have to tell you, but I will read it to you. That moment when you realize it spells horse. See how long that takes you. Yeah, if you haven't figured it out, just read the white on the painted horse. Or my ultimate favorite one, the last one we got here. You've all seen Colonel Sanders before. You know who this guy is. The problem is, once I say this, you'll never be able to look at Colonel Sanders in the same way again. What if I said Colonel Sanders, big head, tiny body? Every time you see this picture for the rest of your life, guess what you're going to see? I just realized, or I just ruined Colonel Sanders for you. You see, the choice of our focus goes a long way to determining the choice of our reality. Do you choose to focus on your desires, or do you choose to focus on God's desires for you? In Exodus chapter 32, verse 1, when the people saw that Moses was so long coming down from the mountain, they gathered Aaron and said, "Come make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." Now, I need to tell you this story real quick because you need to understand the perspective. This is the same people who were casting a golden calf out of the jewelry that they had combined, who had literally just recently experienced the 10 plagues in Egypt and all the horror that it brought, given by the God that they follow. This is the same Israelites who walked on dry ground through the parting of the waters at the Red Sea when most of the Egyptian army behind them was swallowed up by those waters and drowned and killed. And when that happened, you know what Scripture says? When the Israelites saw the great power of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses, his servants. They had just been through this. They had just put their trust and faith in God and in Moses, and Moses leaves for a couple days, and now it's, what are we going to do? This is all after they were guided by a cloud of smoke by day and a pillar of fire by night. This is during the time when their food was literally daily provided for them in the form of manna and quail. This is when they didn't have any water to drink. They were all thirsty. So God told Moses, take your stick and strike a rock. And it did. And that rock produced enough water for them as a nation to drink. What I'm getting at here is simply this. We are not any more immune from idolatry than children of Israel were. And they literally experienced God's hand upon their life. Instead of trusting in God, they chose to focus on what they didn't have, not what they did have. Their focus reverted away from God and onto other areas of their life. Are your daily needs and provisions met by your own hands or through a God who loves you, cares for you, and provides for your daily needs? You see, I ask this question very specifically because we often don't equate God's provision in our lives in similar proportion to how God cares for the Israelites. But we should. We should. Did you create the food that you eat? Well, yeah, I went out and I hunted it. But did you create the animal that you hunt? But it's okay because I grow my own food and have a garden, so I created my own food. Did you make the seed? Do you cause the seed to grow? Do you give it sun and water in direct proportions? Because I don't know anybody who can control the sun in here. If the air was removed from the world that we live in, literally, your next breath and your next minutes are dependent upon the air that we breathe. Can you produce your own air? We are every bit as dependent upon God as the children of Israel were, but we don't realize it. When I say that your focus goes a long way into determining your reality, this is what I'm referring to. God's love and God's provision for us versus our perception of his love and provision for us. The article I read earlier, the author goes on to state later, he says, the answer is to love God more. We must allow ourselves to be filled with the fullness of God so our love for him shoves everything else aside, out of his presence, out of the God place in our hearts. We must allow God's magnificence, beauty, and glory to fill our hearts and minds. This is why prayer, Bible study, praise, even fasting are so important. These acts help us to see the glory and majesty of God and to diminish our dependence upon created things. We must become like Habakkuk, who essentially said, if I have no food, but I have God, then I will rejoice. Or like Jeremiah, who said, even when my city and my people are in ruins, the Lord is my portion and I will hope in him. Or like Paul, who said, everything else is rubbish except for knowing the Lord. The only people whose hearts are truly free from idols are those who can honestly say, the Lord is all I need. He is my joy, my hope, my pursuit, my life, and my all. When we let God be our God, when we are completely satisfied in Him, and when we completely embrace the salvation He offers, we won't go looking for things anywhere else. We will have absolutely no need for false gods. We won't look to money, we won't look to our hobbies, we won't look to our spouse or our children or any other created thing to satisfy or save us. Because of that, we won't expect them to be perfect or eternal. We will love them, cherish them, and enjoy them for who they are and what they are. You'll never enjoy anyone or anything else in creation when you expect it to be perfect or eternal. But when you are fully satisfied in God, you can cherish and be thankful for all the good things God has created for us to enjoy. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 18 says these words, they know nothing, they understand nothing, their eyes are plastered over so they cannot see. Their minds are closed so that they cannot understand. May our eyes and minds be humbly uncovered and open to seeing and understanding of a God who loves deeply, who provides richly, and who connects intimately to us and simply desires the same in return. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you for your word. God, I pray that it would challenge us to our core, that we would focus on you, and in our focus on you and our love for you and our experience of you, all our cares would diminish in proportion. Let us have the right motives in our heart. Let us have the right motives in our soul, and let us seek after you in all we do. Thank you for loving us. Help us to love you in return. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.